Today's crime to be discussed is one that has fascinated many people. It's one that was planned and executed so perfectly that it was indeed the perfect crime. It left the FBI, ATF, and the Pennsylvania State Police puzzled for nearly 2 years. It is truly the only crime of its kind and is one of the most complex and bizarre stories that I've ever heard of, ever read. And now I'm here to tell it to you. And if you already heard it, sis, you can still stay. It's cool.
Just minutes before his live shot, the collar bomb around Brian Wells' neck detonated. Wells was a pizza delivery man for Mamma Mia Pizzeria in Erie for many years.
Marjorie Deal was born February 26, 1949. She was an only child and a Pisces. Back at it with the Pisces. Y'all should have known it was not going to be long before there was another one of them that we're covering. But we love y'all here. That's a part of the family. We don't judge y'all for the sins of your brother. Not at all. While we on the subject of horoscopes, when I was trying to verify that I had her horoscope right by the date range, look at this. I came across this chart that had an extra one in there, and it was like the new horoscopes. I instantly go to my birthday, and it has me down as a Libra now. Baby, let me tell you something. I'd be a hoe out on Fig Row before I go from being a Scorpio to a Libra. No shade to the Libras. Love y'all, but I've been a Scorpio all this time, and we gonna ride it out. I don't know what they're trying to do. I can't even pronounce that. I don't know where it came from, but it can go to hell, okay? Mother is a Scorpio, honey. And that's on Mary Had a Little Lamb and on McDonald having a farm. Marjorie was described as a very awkward child. She was very much a social outcast. This resulted in her feeling very alone throughout her childhood because she wanted to be accepted. She wanted to be invited to the dance and asked to dance and all of the things. But unfortunately, her classmates and the neighborhood children, they wanted nothing to do with her unless it was something that could benefit them. It wasn't until her parents built her an actual life-size dollhouse that the neighborhood kids wanted to come over and play with this. Like, they were not trying to play with her before. Once she got this dollhouse, they all of a sudden were interested in her and wanted to play. And even though it was all about the dollhouse instead of her, she longed for like social acceptance and some friends so bad that she didn't care how she obtained it. She didn't mind that they were using her. She just was happy to have the company. Her transition from childhood into adulthood was much like the age-old ugly duckling turned beautiful swan tail, which quiet as it's kept and loud as I'm a telling, honey. She ended up reverting back to that old ugly duckling. It didn't stick. Having her newfound looks brought on her newfound confidence, and it really brought her out of her shell, and she was able to showcase her more charismatic side, which really helped her out there in the social world. And men especially really loved her. Like, she was cute. She really was a pretty lady. And the men wanted a piece. She was very articulate. She had a very high IQ. She actually graduated 12th of her class and was the valedictorian. And her class was like 413 children. So sis was very smart. And she was very well known for that. And although things in her life were going in the direction that she had pretty much always dreamed that they would, she had friends now. She had the men chasing after her. She looked good. She was admired for her intelligence. But there was this one nagging observation that she had made about herself that constantly bothered her. But she didn't really understand what it was. It wasn't something that she could put into words. She just knew that it made her different. Like, different from everyone else. And it really bothered her because she had finally adapted to society's standards of beauty and grace, but something was still very, very off about her. And sis was like, well, damn, it's always something. At the age of 23, she decides to go see a therapist to address this. And like I said, it wasn't something that she really could put into words. All she could manage to say was that something was wrong with her mind and that it made her very sad about her inability to have close and gratifying relationships. She recognized this about herself, and she recognized also that it was not all that normal. Marjorie is diagnosed with bipolar disorder. In the following year, she sees several other mental health professionals and receive additional diagnostics. She was diagnosed by one as having pressured speech, one diagnosed her with mania, and one doctor reportedly disagreed with all of the previous diagnoses, and he said that she was just simply a narcissist with personality disorder. But isn't personality disorder a diagnosis though? Despite her struggles with her mental health, she continues to excel in college, earning herself 2 degrees, one in sociology, the other in social work. Shout out to all the social workers out there. I know people be getting on y'all nerves. But after college, she really struggled to keep a job. And she had also begun to struggle like with everyday life, period. Just simple everyday things became a struggle for her. Her accomplishments and her intellect paired with the fact that she just struggled to maneuver throughout the world really haunted her. And this is something that really, really made her sad. And she began to let herself go. When she began to let herself go, she really spiraled because sis had worked so hard on her glow up. And here she was receding back down to the ugly duckling. It's also kind of affected her personality because she became very bitter and she started to get a little mean. Sis was just upset and rude and unhappy. Nevertheless, she begins dating a man by the name of Robert Thomas. Now, he too struggled with his mental health. When the two got together, they began using recreational drugs together to kind of, I guess, cope with their demons, but this just made stuff worse. The relationship was oftentimes very volatile. They will argue all the time, but regardless of this, they were committed to each other in this relationship. So they will always come back to each other and return to their cesspool of toxicity and drama. That is until one evening in 1984, where one of their arguments ended with Marjorie putting 6 bullets in his chest. She calls for the police, they come out, she is arrested, and she's charged. She was able to convince the jury that she had only done so in self-defense, and that in that moment, she legitimately fear for her life and that it would have been him or her. Now that same year, she meets and marries a man by the name of Richard Armstrong, but her relationship with him ended in that same year as well. Sis had a lot going on for 1 year. This relationship abruptly ended, not because the two could not get along and decided to divorce. No. One evening while the two are at home, Richard has a horrible fall. He hits his head on their coffee table. Marjorie calls for an ambulance. The ambulance comes out. They take him to the hospital. But he unfortunately succumbs to his injuries. And the details of exactly how he fell are unknown. Like, they never suspected foul play. They never investigated. Even with what she had just gone through with her previous boyfriend, like, nobody questioned anything. Marjorie turns around and files a lawsuit against the hospital, and she actually wins a settlement for $175,000. She had also made a very strange request to the hospital, which was for them to give her a piece of Robert's leg bone just in case in the future cloning becomes a thing and she'll be able to clone him. Maybe they're not giving you that. I don't know where you're from, but they don't do that where I'm from. And apparently they didn't do that from where she was from either, because they told her ass no. In the year 2000, Marjorie suffers a devastating blow when she loses her mother. And this devastated her because she admired her mother a lot. Her and her father had also been very close, but they had grown distant a little bit with the changes in her behavior. Marjorie had continued to become more and more unpleasant to be around. She was very abrasive. She was very rude, very manipulative even, because she had this complex that she knew that her IQ was above average and that she was very smart. And she knew that she was smarter than a lot of people around her. So she would often play on that and use that to her advantage. And Papa Bear had enough. He just preferred not to really just be around her at all. Her parents together over the years, they had done really well for themselves. And they were very frugal, so they had saved most of the money. At this point, they had a little over $1 million in their savings. So they had done very well saving money. Marjorie, she was looking forward to the money from the insurance policy, but she began hearing rumors that her dad was squandering their fortune, that he was just giving money out to neighbors, family friends, family members, just everybody, anybody who needed some money. So she goes out to his home and requests her portion of the money that she felt was rightfully owed to her. And her father pretty much told her to beat it. He was like, girl, get out of here. I don't have anything for you. And in the interview, he stated that because he felt like his daughter would use the money for more bad than good, that's why he refused to give her the money, that she just would not be responsible with it. And he preferred to help people that he felt were more deserving or like needed it. And this very much upset Marjorie. She wasn't happy about this at all. Sis was mad. Now, he kept his money down to PNC Bank, and he actually takes the money left behind from her mother that she viewed as her inheritance and put it in a safety deposit box at that same bank, PNC Bank. On August 28, 2003, a 46-year-old pizza delivery man by the name of Brian Wells walks into PNC Bank. He stands in line and patiently waits on his turn to approach the teller, and when it is his turn, he slides her a note demanding $250,000. Now, he doesn't appear to be armed or dangerous or abrasive or aggressive or anything like that. He looked like your average Joe with a walking cane. But in actuality, that walking cane was really a shotgun that was ready to look like a cane. He calmly warns the teller that she must act quickly because he does not have that much time. Unfortunately, she only has $8,000 in her drawer, and so he just takes that. She's placing the money inside the bag that he'd given her. Meanwhile, he takes a lollipop from the little candy dish child and begins eating it. He urges her once again to hurry up because he is on limited time, and then he quickly grabs the bag and he leaves just as calmly as he had come in. Brian gets into his car and he makes it a little bit down the street before the police pull him over. They immediately force him out of the vehicle and onto the ground. He gives the police the same cryptic message that he had given the teller, that he was short on time and that he ain't got time for none of this. But this time, he gives a reason why he's so pressed for time. He tells the officer that underneath the shirt that he is currently wearing, there's an explosive collar that is fixated around his neck. Now, at this point, they have him sitting on the ground with his legs crossed, and they cut off the shirt, and there it is. It's this device that looks like a single handcuff just sitting there around his neck. His hands are behind his back. He's very, very calm, but he is visibly nervous because everybody be a little nervous when they're about to get arrested or when they're being arrested, typically. Initially, police were not completely convinced that the device was like a live device, that it was real. But of course, they couldn't take the chance because that wouldn't be a good idea. So they immediately call for the bomb squad to come out onto the premises and check things out and do what they do. This isn't something that the regular police were equipped to handle at all. While they're waiting for them to show up, the police decide to question him further. And he is claiming that he had nothing to do with this, that he was completely an unwilling participant, that he was just a regular old pizza guy. He went out on a delivery to deliver two pizzas, and a group of black people jumped him and placed his collar around his neck, gave him the note, and sent him into the bank. But he was unable to give any other physical descriptions of these perpetrators who had jumped him and put this on his neck. Now, y'all, we do plenty of things, but this ain't one of them. So sorry about it. And the police actually agreed. They were like, yeah, that don't sound quite right. They immediately thought that it was highly unlikely that this little patch of black people was behind this. And so they thought that he was responsible and he was just, you know, drawing it off on some black people. Officers are dispatched down to the pizza shop that he worked at to question his co-workers. They all claim that around 1:30, roughly an hour or so before the heist, a call came into the pizza shop and the owner actually answered it, but he was having a difficult time understanding the caller. So he hands the phone over to Brian for him to take their order and get all of the details. Brian gets the order and he also writes down an address. The location of the delivery was a very remote location and came up just as like a little field or area of grass. So he had written down the directions on a slip of paper, 8631 Peach Street. Moments later, the pizzas are ready. He leaves with the order and is off to make his delivery. And they had not seen or heard from him since. Meanwhile, back at the scene, the device begins to beep. As time progresses, the pace of the beeping increases. Brian is becoming visibly more and more anxious as the beeping gets faster and faster because the squad had not shown up and this thing was still very tightly fixated around his neck, and he was very wary. Up until this moment, he actually hadn't appeared to be nervous about the device. He was very calm, which is part of the reason why the police thought that maybe it wasn't real, because his demeanor made it seem as though he just, like, maybe it wasn't a real thing, that he was just under arrest for a bank heist. The pace of the beep is getting faster and faster. He's becoming more and more anxious, and then suddenly it detonates. Seconds later, the bomb squad arrives, but unfortunately, it is too late for Brian. Now, the bomb squad might have been black, because, you know, notoriously, us black folks be late to everything. Now, a little bit about Brian's background. Brian Wells was, as previously stated, a 46-year-old pizza delivery guy who had no previous run-ins with the law, no criminal history whatsoever. He had never gotten into any kind of trouble. When the police go out and question his neighbors, they describe him as being a very, very nice, very kind guy, kind of quiet and almost childlike. He had grown up there in Erie, Pennsylvania, and he had never gotten married or had any children. But he did come from a very loving and caring family. He had a couple of pet cats that he loved dearly. He did not have many friends, but he did have a regular routine of taking his elderly mother out to the movies, and he would take her to concerts often. He would oftentimes invite her friends to go as well. And something that a lot of people knew about Brian is that he really, really enjoyed scavenger hunts. He was known around town as being one of the few people who actually participated in this portion of the newspaper called the Great Key Hunt. Every day there would be this scavenger hunt portion in the newspaper that would give clues and instructions to find this key that would typically be hidden at various landmarks around the city. This is something that he really enjoyed doing, like, a lot. And it sounds kind of cool to me too. One of his neighbors, this very, very sweet lady who had known him for years, she was in complete disbelief that something like this had happened. She did not believe for a second that this is something that he had planned and decided to do on his own, but she did say that she felt like, because he was very easily influenced, that somebody else could have put him up to this. She too described him as a very, very kind man with like a childlike persona. She said that he had this innocence about him that just could not allow her to believe for a second that this was his plan, that this was his doing. But she could believe that he was coaxed into doing it by someone else. From there, police decide to turn their attention to the one friend that he did have, Robert Panetti. Robert Panetti was a 43-year-old man who also worked at the pizza shop that Brian worked at. And the two would often spend time outside of work together, mostly to like go and gamble. At this time, police go down to the pizza shop specifically looking for Brian, and when they find him, he's very, very upset because now he has witnessed the loss of his friend on national TV. Brian is very, very upset, very distraught, and when they tell him that they need to interview him, he actually tells them that the events of today were just all too much. He wasn't in the space really to interview. And he asked if it was okay for him to schedule an interview at the police station on the following Monday, to which they agree. And the police, they go on about their business. Now, back at the scene, police are searching Brian's car and they find 9 pages worth of notes and instructions for not only the heist, but for a scavenger hunt. At completion, he would have located the keys needed to remove the device from Ryan's neck, and it stated that the timer was set for 55 minutes. So he had 55 minutes to get into the bank, get the money, hit these spots, get the keys, and remove the device. Immediately, police set off on this route to try to finish the scavenger hunt and see what they can find. The first stop was right off of an exit off of a main highway, and it was right alongside the side of the road. There was this coffee container. When they opened the coffee container, inside was the clue for spot number 2. The second spot was this slightly wooded area in this field, and immediately they noticed that there is this tree that is tagged with this orange tape with Vietnam written on it, and so they're like, okay, this is the second clue. But as they're checking that out across the field on this little dirt road, they spot this blue minivan like slowly approaching, and then all of a sudden the blue van stops and it sits there for a second, hesitates, and then it backs away and drives off. They did not get close enough for the police to see inside the vehicle to get like a description of who was inside, nor were they close enough to see the license plate when they sped off. They had a feeling that this person had something to do with it, but unfortunately they were unable to pursue the car because it was no way for them to drive from the main road where the police vehicles were positioned through the trees and make it to their back road. Like, it was literally physically impossible. And so whoever it was got away. And honey, meanwhile, back at the scene, the FBI shows up. Because this is a bank heist, it's technically a federal offense. But ATF was still on the scene when the FBI showed up and were like, nah fam, there was an explosive. So this is us. Like, this is our business. ATF was adamant that this was within their jurisdiction and this was their case. And child, the state police, who had been there first on the scene and all the time, they were like, baby, both of y'all can kick rocks with no socks because we were here first on the scene. Baby, this happened on our turf. we got this. So both of y'all can go to hell, respectively. That's what the police said. They debate back and forth about whose case it is. Meanwhile, they still have Brian laying there in the street. And finally, a call from the higher-ups is made, and it is determined that the FBI, this will be their case, but they had to allow ATF and the police, the state police, to help. Like when your mama said, you can go to the party, but you got to take your little brother, your little sister with you. And you're like, damn, okay, but now it's not going to be as fun. Nevertheless, they decide to divide and conquer. The FBI's first order of business was to get an immediate search warrant for Bryant's residence. When they get to his home, they tear that thing up looking for any little shred of evidence, any clue, anything that had anything to do with what happened today, but they don't find anything. Like, they're unable to find anything that tells them that this was previously planned or in the works. ATF, their first order of business was to examine the device itself. They wanted to try to figure it out, but they claimed that they could not properly do so until it had been removed from Brian, and they wanted to preserve the device. So a decision was made to remove his head in order to get the device without damaging it. And lastly, the police, they go and seized the surveillance footage from inside the bank that showed the entire heist unfold. And a few things strike them as odd behavior. For someone who was a mere hostage, Brian appeared to them to be extremely calm and comfortable walking into the bank and standing there waiting on the money. He walked in unbothered and walked out swinging the bag of money, eating his lollipop like he didn't have a care in the world. They really thought this was odd for someone who was innocently thrown into this last minute, who also had a live device around their neck. And so they weren't convinced that he wasn't the mastermind behind this whole thing. They also go and check out the delivery site location, and there they find shoe prints and tire marks that matches Brian's shoes in his car. It also appeared that a struggle had ensued right there, like in the dirt and grass. But ultimately, there was no DNA found on any of the items that they had collected from the scene, nor was there any other person's DNA inside of Brian's car, on the device itself, or the cane. There was like no DNA anywhere, just Brian. Nevertheless, they continue to try and collect any kind of evidence that they could find. They continue to question people and try to find something out. Now, on Sunday, August 31st, co-worker and friend of Brian, Mr. Robert Panetti, he is found unresponsive by his family the night before he is to interview with the detectives. While the police are waiting on the COD to be determined, they decide to return to the pizza shop and question like the other employees, this time regarding Robert instead of Brian. And the employees are telling them that Brian had begun to act very strange after the heist up until the last day that he had worked. He was very, very strange acting. He was very paranoid. He was saying that he needed protection in case they came after him next. And police are baffled because they're like, who is they? Like, is there a they, or is he just paranoid because he believes the story that Brian told, which is the group of people had jumped him and done this to him? At this point, they narrow it down to three possible scenarios. One, Brian Wells acted alone, but they felt like if that were the case, why would he use a live device? The second scenario is that Brian did not act alone, that he actually was abducted by this other group and forced into this situation unwillingly and was actually a victim himself. And the third was that Brian and Robert Panetti planned this whole thing together. The toxicology report comes back revealing that Brian's COD was an overdose. But they still questioned whether it was accidental or done on purpose, because it was kind of odd that it happened the night before he was scheduled to interview with the police. They did not believe that that was a coincidence at all. But this didn't get them any closer to figuring out what exactly had happened. There was still no evidence, and none of it was really making sense. So the FBI decided to release the profile of the person that they thought would be behind this whole plan if this was not done by Brian and Robert Panetti. They describe him as a very frugal person, a person of high intelligence, one that was very good with like metal and wood and like building stuff. Child, I could have came up with that profile. Like, we all know that. Now, by this time, ATF had thoroughly examined the device itself. They had actually found that the timer was activated by the removal of a pin, and that there was actually a second pin that would have given Brian another hour if it had been removed. So they're feeling like, if he was behind this, wouldn't he have known to remove that pin and extend his time? But he was handcuffed. They had taken the device apart and they attempted to individually identify the different components to see if they could track a purchase or track the individual components to a business or just make any kind of connection that would get them closer to finding out who had constructed it. But they didn't have any success with that. They could not identify any of the components. It was also determined that it would have been virtually impossible for Brian to complete the scavenger hunt within 55 minutes. When they went on the entire route, the exact same day and time that this had taken place of the next week, they found that it literally would have been impossible for him to make that complete circle within 55 minutes. This brought up the question of whether or not it really was about a heist, or was Brian never meant to survive this at all, from conception. Despite the FBI's appeals to the public, and largely due to their lack of evidence, it became quite evident that they would not be able to figure this out without somebody coming forward who either was involved or who had inside knowledge. But as far as the FBI knew, nobody was spilling the tea. No leads, no witnesses. It literally was the perfect crime. It literally had them stuck. 3 weeks after the Brian Wells incident, 911 dispatcher receives a call from a man claiming that at 8645 Peachtree, in a freezer inside of the garage, there was a body. And there was a woman there at the house who they might want to pick up and question in regard to this. The dispatcher is like, "How do you know this?" And the man on the phone is like, "Trust me, I know." The dispatcher then asks the caller to identify themselves, and he says that he is the man that lives there and gives his name as Bill Rothstein. When asked if he knew the woman's name who was at the house and he claimed was responsible, he replies yes and gives the name Marjorie Deal. 911 dispatcher then asks Bill what is his relationship to the woman, and he hesitates and then he says, "I'll tell you guys my story later." Then the dispatcher asks if he knows the identity of the person that he claims is inside the freezer, and once again he hesitates, but he does give the name as James Roden, and then he hangs up. A few hours go by, and once again a call is placed to 911. The caller immediately identifies himself as Bill Rothstein, and he is questioning whether or not they had checked out the scene that he had told them about earlier. And he asks if Marjorie had been arrested. The dispatcher advises him that, "Oh no, but we're checking it out right now as we speak, and no arrests have been made, but we're checking it out. Don't you worry." And truthfully, nobody had been dispatched out to the house yet. Inside of the police office where the dispatch call is taken, State Trooper Ron Morgan, he overhears what's being said, and he immediately recognizes the name Bill Rothstein. Bill had been the best man at one of his in-laws' wedding, and he had a particularly memorable personality and arrogance. Bill was a very, very intelligent man, and he knew that, and he bragged and boasted about that. He was very proud of the fact that he was smarter than most, so he was kind of a hard guy to forget. Ron immediately takes over the phone call, and he's like, "Bill, girl, what'd you say?" Bill tells him what he had previously told the dispatcher and also reveals that the person in the freezer is Marjorie's boyfriend. He is telling Ron that they need to hurry up and pick up Marjorie. He describes her as this very highly intelligent but diabolical woman who was highly manipulative. And he admits that he's actually afraid of her. Bill is like, "Look, I know this may sound crazy, but I'm literally telling the truth and somebody needs to come out here right away." He also informs Ron that Marjorie had put James in the freezer, and now she wanted Bill to take him out and put him through a wood chipper. And he said that he did not want to do that and that somebody needs to come take care of this right now. The state trooper tells Bill, "Come down to the station, give an interview. We can do a proper police report. In the meantime, you don't have to worry about being afraid of her because you'll be at the station and you'll be protected and you'll be safe." And so Bill agrees to do so. Because they'll be calling down to the police station from in the closet when sis is still walking around the premises if she really is this dangerous and crazy. That ain't it. Bill was very much willing to go down to the station ASAP. Now, remember the address of the pizza delivery spot Brian was sent to was 8631 Peach Street. Bill's house was 8645 Peach Street. And Ron said that during the time that Brian's heist was unfolding, he thought about how close that location was to Bill's house, but he immediately brushed off the thought because he said, surely Bill couldn't have had anything to do with this because he's not that kind of guy. And so he just thought it was a coincidence. So Bill comes down to the station and gives his interview, basically stating the same thing that he had stated over the phone. Meanwhile, police are dispatched out to both locations. Bill's house, 8645 Peach Street, and Marjorie's house. And she lives just a couple of houses down from him. One officer goes over to Bill's house to try to locate the freezer and take a look inside, while the other officers, they go over to Marjorie's house because she was home by this time. They're actually just stalling and trying to distract her while the other officer checks out the scene. When he gets there, he immediately notices this black tarp that was draped over the deep freezer. Opens it up, takes a look inside, and just as Bill has stated, there is someone inside of it. He goes over to Marjorie's house, and it's a mess. Like, inside, it's like hoarders times a million. She has stuff stacked up to the ceiling. Look at these pictures, girl. It's a mess. The officer barely could walk through. He had to literally clear his path as he went through the house to get to her bedroom where she was with the other officers. When he gets in there, she is fussing at the officers. She's demanded that they leave. He confirms that what Bill had claimed was true, and sis is placed under arrest. As she's being arrested, she's like, wait, hold on, no, like, I didn't do that. She appeared very shocked and taken aback that she was being accused of doing this. She immediately began to claim that her neighbor Bill was responsible for that. She had nothing to do with it, and she don't know what they're talking about. But they're not trying to hear it. They hauls that ass down to jail. Meanwhile, Bill is down at the station and he is talking to them about his history with Marjorie. He tells them that he's known her for 30 to 35 years and that one day she just called him up and said that she needed to come over. She confesses to him what she had done to James, and then she breaks down into hysterics and she's crying and she's like, nobody can help me but you. You're the only one I can depend on. Help me. At first, he feels bad for her. He feels sorry for her. So he agrees to help her clean up. And his smart idea was to remove James from her house and put him in a safe space. And that's how he ended up in the freezer. Like, Bill, he admits to that much. But he said that sis wanted James completely gone. So she began pressuring him, constantly asking him, like, you have to dispose, it has to go, and you have to find a way to do it. You say you were gonna help me. And as the days go on, he decides that all of this is just too much. Like, it's just too much for him to bear and deal with. He decides to instead go to the police and turn homegirl in. Marjorie is constantly denying all of the things. Sis said that Bill is lying. Marjorie claimed that James had been her man for over 10 years and that he deeply loved her. Not that she deeply loved him or they deeply loved each other, child. She came home one day, found him unresponsive, and she believes that Bill did it because he would have reason to. He was extremely jealous of James because he wanted her all for himself, and he felt like James was in the way of that. She said that she was very much afraid of Bill, and so she does not challenge him at all. That he then went out and purchased a meat grinder because that's what he was initially going to use as a means of disposal. When they asked Bill about the meat grinder, because he didn't mention this, but when they asked him about it, he says, oh yeah, I did purchase it, but I was just out buying stuff just to make it seem like I was going along with it and trying to buy myself some time. And in the meantime, he wanted her to believe that he was actually going to satisfy her request. Now, the FBI, which had pretty much moved into this little portion of the police office while they were in town working to solve the Brian Wells heist case, they overhear this going on and they want to go in and question Bill and question Marjorie. But the police were like, nah, y'all came in and y'all jacked our last case. No, this ain't got nothing to do with a bank. This is not federal. And this ain't your business. They have a little back and forth again. And then it is determined that because the FBI believed that they may have had something to do with the Brian case, which is why they wanted to question them, they were allowed to go in and speak to both of them. Honey, the FBI agent walks into the interrogation room where Bill is being held and simply says, Bill, I'm Jerry Clark from the FBI. Bill, I'm Jerry Clark from the FBI. And Sis's response is, well, let me tell you something. I want you to know right off top that I'm the smartest guy in this room. The FBI agent felt like this was an odd response and thought it was weird that he was kind of defensive out of nowhere. But to lighten up the mood, because he did need Bill to answer some questions for him, he just kind of brushed it off with a joke, telling Bill that his wife tells him that same thing all the time. Bill does not laugh. The FBI agent asked Bill if he thought that there was a possible connection between this case and the Brian Wells case, and Brian says no, there is no relationship. He then tells the FBI agent that he can't talk about the Brian Wells case. Now, Bill was a very bold man, and it was partly due to the way that he'd grown up. He was a rich kid, and his family ran the famous Rolla-Cola bottling plant and had a lot of money and a lot of influence, so he was also very well known. But unfortunately, kids don't really be caring about money like that. Because much like Marjorie, he was outcasted by his peers. They didn't really care for him at all. He didn't really have many friends. He was also bullied mercilessly by the other children. After high school, he had gone off to college, but he returned home shortly after. He did not finish, and it was not because he wasn't doing well in school. He just decided that he would prefer to work at the family business. He was a very, very intelligent man. That's something that he also had in common with Marjorie. Both of them were much higher intelligence than the average person, and both of them were very proud of that fact, and they were very arrogant and cocky about it. But with Bill, to those closest to him, he was a very, very kind man. He was very charismatic. He was very well liked, very generous, and was described as very thoughtful and helpful despite his arrogance. Somewhere around 1974, 1975, at the age of 21, he meets 25-year-old Marjorie Deal. And despite her very nasty demeanor and her rudeness, he becomes completely enamored with her. A friend of Bill said that what transpired between the two of them seemingly went beyond just attraction, like the average attraction between two people. Instead, it was as if she had gotten into his psyche. And this friend would tell Bill that he needed to cut her off, sever ties with her, and get over her, because she just was not a good person. She was too controlling, too toxic, and he just didn't need that in his life. But Bill wasn't trying to hear that. He loves her. He wasn't trying to hear none of what homeboy was talking about. Nobody could tell him anything about Marjorie. So to him, it came as no surprise that Marjorie was able to talk Bill into going into her home, retrieving a body, and putting it in his freezer. That was the kind of sick and depraved, like, control or influence that she had always had over him. She was a manipulator and he was her subservient, and that's the dynamic that they had always had. They had dated off and on for a couple of years and even were engaged at one point, but Marjorie called it off because she said that Bill was, like, obsessed with legs. He had this weird attraction to legs, and he would like to rub his little thing all up against her leg all the time. And he got off on that. I wonder if he preferred them hairy or if they had to always be clean shaved. I wonder what his preference was. Imagine if they were hairy, though. Anywho, eventually, she had had enough. She had grown sick of that. She never got used to it. She thought it was weird, and it eventually turned her off from him. And so she decides to cut off their engagement because she said, I'm not going to be doing this forever. I can't be doing this my whole life. But Bill does not take this well because he loves Marjorie. He actually confided in her and told her that after she cut off the engagement, his life immediately began to spiral and he was just so unhappy. And she felt bad for that, so she decided to stay close, which is why they lived so close together. She decided to remain close to him physically and have a close relationship with him, but she never again wanted to be in a romantic relationship with him. And in all the 30 years that had passed since she cut off their engagement, he had never seriously dated another woman. No other woman ever lived in the house with him. He just remained in that house alone. Now, the FBI agent goes and speaks with Marjorie and asks her about Brian Wells. She's like, what?
Bro, what are you talking about, man?
I don't know anything about that. She denies having any knowledge about that. She's just like, what are you talking about? She further supports her stance that she had nothing to do with it, stating she would have had no motive because she doesn't need money. She got money. However, she alludes to Bill having something to do with it, stating that he, on the other hand, would do anything for money. Sis is tired of being questioned. She tells detectives, look, I'm mentally ill, but I'm not violent, okay? I'm not guilty of any of the things that I've been accused of here today. I need to be released. She is telling them she never would have done anything like this to James. Detectives go back into Bill's room and they ask for details, like specific details about the moment that she came to him. First, Bill couldn't recall whether it was night or morning. Like, how do you not know that, sir? Not only that, he could not recall the exact phrases or the exact conversation that they had. No specific details. It was just like, oh, she said she did this and she wanted me to come get rid of it. The more in-depth questions that they ask, the more flustered he becomes. He's visibly agitated. And in the end, every answer was, I don't know, or I don't recall. When investigators go out to Marjorie's home to attempt to collect some type of evidence, it's virtually impossible with all of the stuff she has packed into her home. So that was a bust. Sis even had dead cats inside the house that had just been left there, and live cats that were also still there. That had to be disturbing for the cats. Imagine. But they're not getting anywhere as far as collecting any evidence, and so they decide to call in some of Bill and Marjorie's closest friends and family for questioning in regard to, you know, these folks and what they got going. Now, in doing so, it's quickly revealed that Marjorie actually had confided in a friend and told them that she wanted James out of the picture, and that Bill also wanted him out of the picture because Bill wanted Marjorie to get rid of James so that he could marry her. Another friend of Marjorie's is questioned by the name of Kenneth Barnes, whom she would often go fishing with, and her and James would hang out with Kenneth and his girlfriend a lot. Kenneth tells detectives that Marjorie is very toxic and that she treated James terribly. He describes James as a very nice and very timid man, completely opposite of her. He also tells investigators that on several occasions he had witnessed Marjorie threatening James' life. She would tell him that she would do it or she could easily have someone else do it for her. Kenneth asked James, like, why do you stay with her? Why do you not leave? And James told Kenneth that she couldn't help her outburst, that she was ill, and although it seems like she's always just this aggressive, horrible person, half of the time she is the complete opposite of that, and she's very sweet. And he just felt like she just couldn't help it, like she couldn't help the bad days or the outbursts, and that he loved the good side of her enough to weather like the storm of the bad side. So sweet. Somebody can love me like that. Kenneth also tells investigators about how she would often brag about what she had done back in 1984. And how she had gotten off on self-defense. She would say things like, I hit that mother effer 6 times and got away with it. I just told them that he beat me up. And she would laugh about it. Now, detectives can't definitively determine who is lying and who is responsible between Bill and Marjorie, so they place them both under arrest. Because Bill is fully cooperative and playing nice, and he also agreed to give a full tour of the crime scene, he is given a bail and he is released out on bail. Marjorie, however, is not given one, not released, and she is held behind in her cell, pissed. Bill's house was included in the tour, and one of the officers noticed right away this note on a desk, like this handwritten note, and they bring it to Bill's attention and question him about it, and he's like, oh, before I decided to come forward and turn her in, I contemplated just ending my own life, just saying goodbye, cruel world, and leaving. And he said that that was the note that he was going to leave behind. The first line in the note is, this has nothing to do with the Brian Wells case. And so the detectives thought that was odd. Like, why even bring it up? And they asked him that, like, why would you even put this in the note? And he said that he just didn't want police to think, oh, he must have done it, he must have felt guilty or something, and feel like the case was closed and solved and over with. And so that's why he specifically put that in the note. They accept the answer, but they still kind of thought something wasn't quite right. Nevertheless, they let it go. They are still bringing in people to be interviewed from both sides. And next up was Bill's brother, John. Now, John tells them that despite coming from wealth, Bill had apparently squandered all of his inheritance. And will often call him and their sister asking for money and asking for loans. And he said that he had actually seen his brother the night that James died. He said that Bill seemed very off and very on edge. And he had asked his brother, like, what's up? Like, is there something wrong? What's going on? And Bill had confided in him and told him that he had written his little letter and he was just through with life. But then he decided against it and changed his mind because he didn't have the balls to go through with it. That's what he said. That's not what I said. That's what he said. John said that he then asked Bill, like, what's wrong? What could be so bad that this is what you're thinking about doing? And then Bill tells him, I can't tell you. John said that he just assumed that his brother's emotional state and his recent financial troubles were due to some kind of criminal activity that he had somehow gotten himself wrapped up in. That was just the extent of it. He felt like his brother was in some sort of trouble, but he didn't push the issue. Bill was still living in their parents' home rent-free, and John and their sister decided that they wanted to sell the house. Bill did not want to sell the house. He wanted to remain there. And so they had a disagreement there and a little falling out. But a couple of weeks prior, Bill had finally contacted him and told him that he listed the house for $90,000. But come to find out, he had actually listed it for a much greater price than $90,000. And when the realtor told him that that was too much for that house, Bill told the realtor that his asking price could not be changed, that what he was asking for was what he needed. And guess what the amount was? $250,000. Coincidence or not? When they find this out, they ask Bill to come in and take a polygraph test. He agrees. He's like, oh, I don't have a problem. I can come in and take a lie detector test because I ain't lying. But when he comes in to take it, they notice that he's very sleepy, very tired. He's like yawning, literally struggling to stay awake during the test. And he passes every question. But the FBI felt like that didn't mean anything to them because they knew that he was smart enough to figure out a way to make sure he passed the test, even if he was sitting there lying on every question. They knew sis was fully capable of passing, so they weren't trying to hear that. Now, our good sis Marjorie, or the Pisces good sis Marjorie, rather, sis is still behind bars, and she is pissed off that Bill seemingly has gotten a one-up on her, and he's still out living in his freedom, and she's still locked away behind bars. And so she is trying to think of a way that she could kind of even the score between her and Bill. And finally, she thinks of something. Out of all of the people that they questioned and all of the information that Bill had voluntarily given to detectives, there was one small detail that he had conveniently left out, and sis was ready to put in. Okay, Bill had a whole roommate by the name of Floyd Stockton that had actually moved out of his house the day after the Brian Wells heist. The FBI locates Floyd Stockton. They fly out to interview him. He denies any knowledge of any heist and he passes a lie detector test. When that happens, both him and Bill are officially cleared by the FBI as potential suspects. They were not seriously looking at Marjorie as a suspect for the bank heist, but she did remain behind bars. For James, Bill was only hit with a few misdemeanor charges in relation to the James case, and he was out free, living his best life, waiting on sentencing. Marjorie continues to proclaim her innocence. She also does an interview which she states that Bill had wrongfully framed her for this, and that because the police wouldn't do anything about it, she had asked the universe to take care of him and was hoping that sis would just drop dead like a fly. In 2004, after Marjorie's preliminary hearing, she has another outburst in the courthouse accusing Bill of being the one that's guilty, but not only of the James case, but also the Brian Wells bank heist. She is saying that he needs to be charged for that and a bunch of other crimes. No one pays sis any mind yet again. Over the next several months, Bill starts to lose a lot of weight. He's dropping weight rapidly. He's growing increasingly mean and short-tempered. He's bitter and angry all the time, and he's really nothing like himself. Like, he wasn't known to exhibit any of these characteristics beforehand. This was more Marjorie's speed. Come to find out, he was actually riddled with cancer and it had progressed way past the point of having a chance at recovery. His health was declining rapidly, and not long after he began to get sick, he was admitted into the hospital. Like, he was really in really bad health. The FBI agent goes out to speak with Bill and ask him yet again if he really had something to do with the Brian Wells case. It had been a whole year and they hadn't gotten any closer to closing this case and figuring it out. Like, they literally were getting nowhere. So he thought maybe Bill would want to clear his conscience once and for all if he had something to do with it, because he truly believed that Bill did have something to do with it, but he just couldn't prove it. He goes into Bill's room. Bill is, at this point, he can't even speak. And he asks Bill the question. He's like, hey, I'm here to provide you the opportunity to just clear your conscience before, you know, you check out. And asks Bill straight up, like, did you have anything to do with the Brian Wells bank heist? Bill waves his hand and motions that no, he did not have anything to do with it once and for all.
However, the FBI agent felt like that was bullshit.
He truly felt as though Bill knew he was sick all along and he wanted to flex his intellect one last time before he said goodbye, cruel world, and leave them with the case that they would never be able to solve. Because he was smart, he got off on being smart, but again, he couldn't prove it.
Months after Bill's passing, Marjorie finally confesses to being solely responsible for what happened to James. She claimed they had all been over another woman,
and she requests a plea deal, citing lack of responsibility due to diminished mental capacity.
Child, fancy for saying I was temporarily insane. Forgive me.
Or I did not know what I was doing. It actually works though. She received 7 years minimum with the possibility of parole after the 7 years are served, and she is transferred to a mental hospital instead of remaining inside the prison walls. She was happy about this, but this pissed off a lot of her inmates that have been serving time alongside her, and not just because she was getting to go to the hospital, but because she was faking it. They claimed that she was playing crazy and that Marjorie had confessed horrible things to them while she was behind bars, and that she had also told them of her plans to act crazy to make it to the hospital where the food is better. It don't even look like they use salt in the hospital, so how is the food better, sis? When Marjorie makes it to the hospital, she writes a letter to the police department offering to tell investigators information about the Brian Wells case that would help them out, but not for free. She did not like that they had moved her to a hospital that was so far away from Erie, Pennsylvania, and she wanted to be transferred to a hospital that was either in Erie or very close to Erie. She teased them with this story of how when she first went to Bill to ask him for help, he told her that he couldn't help her that day because he was working on a business project, and she believed that that business project was the planning of the bank heist. She also offered up details of crimes that had been committed by Kenneth Barnes, the friend of hers who had given them information that helped incriminate her in the James situation. And so I guess sis was trying to get him back, baby. She was trying to get her lick back. Sis writes that letter, licks her stamp, sends it off with the mail, and patiently awaits her response. Meanwhile, back at the ranch, what show did I get that from? I don't remember. Meanwhile, back in Erie, Pennsylvania, the FBI are still in town trying to put things together. And at this point, they start to think maybe they should have looked at Marjorie a little closer and consider her to be in on the bank heist a little more seriously. And so they decide that it's not too late. We can go back and check things out. When she went to jail and it was determined that sis would not be coming home anytime soon, they cleared her house out. They threw away all of the trash and then her personal belongings that were actually of value. They put inside of a storage unit, and they have been just sitting in the storage ever since. They decide to go out to the storage unit and re-filter through all of those things to see if they could find anything that kind of related to the bank heist itself. It had been a year and a half since the heist. They were desperate to find something. And finally, they do find that something that they feel kind of supports their theory that she was involved. In one of the boxes, there was a letter, a very angry letter that Marjorie had written to the manager at her bank. She had accused the manager of allowing her father to come in and withdraw all of the contents of her safety deposit box. She said that this was her inheritance and it was wrong for him to do and wrong for them to allow him to do. The bank is PNC Bank, the same bank that the heist had taken place at. Around this time, they also relieved her letter in the mail and they agreed to move her closer, play her little game, and see how far they can get. But they don't mention finding the letter that she had written to PNC Bank. They don't bring that up at all. They just allow her to, like, give what she had to give. The first little golden nugget that sis offered up was a big one. She said that Bill's car that he had always driven up until the day of the heist, he had all of a sudden gotten towed away from the house, literally on the day of the heist, just a couple of hours after. And he had this vehicle towed back to his home on the day that he was cleared by the FBI as a potential suspect in the bank heist. And guess what the car is? A blue minivan. Detectives actually go out and review pictures that were taken by the reporters that came out trying to get, like, a statement from him and took pictures of him as he got back to the house on the day that he was cleared.
And there it was, clear as day, literally in the front yard on the grass, was the exact same blue van that they had seen at the second scavenger hunt spot that had backed away and got on down that dirt road. Yes, sis. That van. I'm trying to see how. Now, I'm gonna give ATF a pass because this ain't really their speed. Like, they came and kind of did what they needed to do. But the state police and the FBI missed this. How, girl? How? The second aha moment that came for detectives way too late was when they decided to compare the handwritten note that they noticed inside of his house and the handwritten instructions on the scavenger hunt. And without any kind of fancy, deep analysis done, they were able to just determine right off the bat, like, definitively, that this was the same handwriting. The exact same handwriting. Just didn't change the way he crossed his T's or dotted his I's. Like, it literally was undoubtedly the exact same handwriting. In the summer of 2005, just about 2 years after the heist, it is talked about on a TV show, America's Most Wanted. And afterward, a lot of tips kind of came in from people that had claimed to see Bill at the Shell station right before the heist, because it had also been revealed that whomever made the phone calls to order the pizzas had done so from the payphone at the Shell station right near the bank. So calls were coming in about how people had seen Bill there at that Shell station around that time. One guy said that he actually saw Bill and he caught his attention because he was wearing overalls, and he was like, nice overalls. And Bill was like, thanks. And then he watched Bill go over to the payphone and meet a woman there. Baby, Geraldo let them have it. He got on TV and talk so bad about the FBI and the state police not being able to figure this out and just being so bad at their job that it was just laughable at that point, and how they never probably would figure this out. And then the FBI didn't appreciate Geraldo too much. This episode also prompted three or four ladies that were previously locked up with Marjorie in the prison that she was in. They also came forward with stories of how she had confessed to having her hand in the whole bank heist, and she was bragging about it. She was bragging about what she had done to James, bragging about what she had done to her previous man. And she claimed to have done what she had done to James, not because of a woman, but because he was threatening to expose the bank heist plot, and she couldn't have that. One of the ladies by the name of Kelly, she had actually taken notes while Marjorie was talking and put this all in a letter and mailed those notes to the police station when it was first going down, like long ago, like almost in real time when sis was first locked up. This letter contained many details that at the time had not been given to the public, and some that had still at that time not been released to the public. And like I said, she had sent this letter off a long, long time ago, but instead of them actually reading the letter or taking it seriously, the letter had been filed away inside of a drawer within a folder that was titled Snitch Letters down at the police station, and was never turned over to the FBI detectives that were investigating the case. Honey, the letters detailed how Bill had built the device himself, how Floyd Stockton had helped him plan the whole heist from conception. It stated that James Roden had to go because he threatened the plan, and it also joked about how they had managed to measure Brian Wells's neck for the device to make sure that it was built specifically to fit him. A connection between Kenneth Barnes and Brian Wells is also able to be made when it is revealed that one of the sex workers that Brian did business with also had an addiction, and she would make her purchases from Kenneth. Brian would pick her up, drive her over to Kenneth's house. She would service him on the second floor. He would pay her for her services, and then she would walk downstairs, make her purchase with Kenneth, and then Brian will go on about his business. They go back and they question Kenneth again because he was always so willing to give all this information up on Marjorie. First, he tells them that he was not involved, but he was asked, however, to take her father out so that she could get back her inheritance plus whatever she would gain from him no longer living. He said that he actually agreed to do it, but he was not going to do it for free. And guess how much he was willing to do it for? $250,000. The amount asked for in the heist and the amount that Bill tried to sell his house for. He said that she did not have that kind of money, but she stood to gain so much more from her inheritance. So she didn't mind paying him that much. She just had to get her hands on the money. So when Bill's house was not selling for $250K, the bank heist plan goes into motion. Up until now, Kenneth had been interviewed by the state police, but the FBI goes back and they review his old police tapes, which they had never been given before, and realize that he had actually mentioned her attempting to hire him for this job before. These tapes, however, were never passed to the FBI, and they were livid yet again. Maybe at this point, they just need to take the police out back and they just need to fight. Now, detectives are like, also, since you was involved in a murder for hire plot, tell us more. And he was like, oh, no, I wasn't going to really do it. I just agreed to do it. And I was going to take the $100K that she was going to give me up front and disappear. That's what he claimed, y'all. He tried to clean that up really quick. Marjorie, of course, denies all of Kenneth's claims. And you know what she says to support the theory that she did not and would not have tried to hire Kenneth for that? Sis said if she wanted something like that done, she obviously knows how to do it herself, and she would have, and that she didn't need anybody to do her dirty work. And sis got a convincing point, but she lied. Kenneth agrees to give detectives a full confession, and it turns out he was actually involved in the whole thing, even the planning of the heist. According to Kenneth's confession, the day before the heist, they had actually had a pre-heist meeting over at Bill's house, where everybody was supposed to link up, find out what their role was supposed to be, and hear the plan in its entirety. When asked who was all present at this pre-heist planning meeting, Kenneth states that he was there, of course, Marjorie was there, Bill was there, Floyd Stockton was there, and guess who else? Robert Panetti and Brian Wells. He said that James was supposed to be there because he was supposed to be the getaway driver, but when she picked Kenneth up for the meeting and asked where James was, Marjorie told him that James was in bed sick with the flu, and so he would not be in attendance at the meeting or the heist because he was just too sick to do it. He also states that on the day of the heist, he and Marjorie pull up to the Shell station and they sit there awaiting Bill, who arrives shortly thereafter. When Bill gets there, she hops out of the car, joins him at the payphone. They place the order for the pizzas, and then all three of them leave and go back to the delivery site and wait for Brian. Brian pulls up with the two pizzas and gets out of the car. The group stands around the car and they're eating the pizza and talking. Everybody is there except Floyd. Floyd is hiding behind this little shed, like this little building structure. Then all of a sudden he emerges from behind the building and he comes up behind Brian with the device open and attempts to put it on Brian's neck. Brian looks very much afraid. He actually attempts to escape, but Kenneth hits him, and then Bill fires like one warning shot into the air and tells Brian that he is not going anywhere, like he is not leaving. He is gonna put on this collar. They hold him down and hold him still while Marjorie and Floyd place the device around his neck and close it and secure it. And Brian is telling them that he does not want to do this, like begging them to just let him go because he don't want no parts and none of this. But of course they're not listening to him. Once they get it secured around him, they place a shirt over him to like cover it and conceal it. They give him the notes. They give him the instructions that if he is apprehended by the police, he is not to reveal what really happened. Instead, he is just to tell them that a group of black people grabbed him and put this on his neck and forced him to do this. They give him the shotgun that they had rigged up to look like a walking cane, and they tell him that it's fully functional, fully operable, and if he needs to use it, then do so. They pull the pin, starting the timer, and let him know that he has 55 minutes to get this done, and they send him on his way. After he leaves, Marjorie and Kenneth position their car directly across the street from the bank with a pair of binoculars that the two passed back and forth between each other to get front row seats of the whole thing go down. But once all the police showed up and they had Brian cuffed and sitting on the ground, they left and went back to Bill's house. Bill was not there when they first got there, but after some time went on, he eventually comes back to the house in the blue van, and he said that he had been spotted and he needed to get rid of the van right away. Also claimed that it was supposed to be a fake device, and that was the plan the whole time, was just to allow Brian to think that it was real. Somewhere between conception and construction, Bill and Marjorie decided to make it real and fully operable. And they didn't let anybody else know. And so he claimed that it was a surprise to everyone when it actually went off. Detectives go to where Floyd is living and they let him know, like, look, the jig is up. We already know you were involved. This is how much we know. So it's probably in your best interest that you just come clean and tell us the real tea. In exchange for full immunity, Floyd Stockton agrees to give a full account of what happened and also testify against Marjorie in court. The story that he tells mirrors Kenneth's. Floyd had actually said that he felt really bad for putting the collar on Brian, and that after the fact, he just didn't even want to be there anymore. Once it was done, he felt really, really bad. And so after putting it on him, he didn't stick around to see how the whole thing played out. He said that immediately after putting the collar on him, he walked away from the group, and he had actually expected Bill to shoot him, but it never happened. Bill just let him go, and he literally never returned to the house. Now, because they are all claiming that Brian was at this pre-meeting in the planning of the heist, he is listed as an unindicted co-conspirator instead of a victim. And this really upsets his family. Like, this pisses his family off. Brian's family denied that he was ever at that meeting, that he would ever partake in such a plan, that he didn't even know anything about their plans. They began showing up at court. They began showing up at press conferences proclaiming Brian's innocence. They literally, is videos of them heckling the FBI agents while they're standing up at the podium, girl, telling the tea as they saw it, which was that Brian was in on it this whole time instead of being a victim. And they were also very upset at the fact that they were never notified that anything had happened to Brian. None of the family was made aware of anything. They literally saw it go down on the news, and still they weren't advised anything, told anything, given any information. And I can't imagine, because the video was very graphic and horrible. And like I said, they had him on the street for hours. Furthermore, they'd removed the head without contacting the family and asking for permission whatsoever. And the family really felt disrespected at the fact that they did so to preserve the device, as if that was more important than the state in which he would be returned to his family. They were completely robbed of the opportunity to have any kind of viewing. This whole thing was just really, really difficult for them. They actually offered Marjorie a plea deal as well, but she rejected it. Sis said that she wanted to go to trial. She wanted her day in court. The only problem with that is she was currently locked away in a mental institution, and so she had to be declared mentally competent to even stay in trial. And after several months of evaluation, she actually was. They said sis was playing crazy and she wasn't really crazy. So I'm sure it wasn't hard for her to change their mind if she was just playing in the first place. Now, Floyd Stockton, who it was part of his deal to testify against Marjorie in court, when it came time for him to testify, he actually had developed like some very severe heart troubles and needed surgery. So he wasn't able to come to court and actually testify after all. But honey, they had enough to go on without Floyd's testimony. After a day and a half of deliberating, the jury decides that sis is guilty and she is sentenced to life in prison plus 30 years straight to prison. Sis had to go. No more hospital, Miss mentally competent to stand trial. See, she should have just sat there at that little hospital, even though it was far from home, done her little 7 years and ate her food. And she probably could have avoided all of this, because her wanting to be moved closer and just really drawing more attention to herself kind of is what opened up this can of worms in the first place and got them to asking questions again. Even if they decided to all confess without her, she could have, and sis got some more time. She was already in the little hospital where the food was better. She could have stayed there, but she talked too much. In April of 2007, she dies in prison of breast cancer at the age of 68. Kenneth Barnes is sentenced to 45 years in prison. He did an interview and stated that he actually preferred the prison life versus being free. because in prison he was forced to be sober, and that's something that he really struggled with out in the free world. And he said that he also got 3 hot meals a day, free shelter, all of his medication that he needed for free, and that he always had company. He said that he was not fearful of the other inmates because people typically don't bother older men like himself in prison. And so he really just didn't have to worry about fighting and being taken. He dies in prison on June 20th, 2019. Throughout the trial and prison, they all maintained that Brian was there at the pre-meeting, pre-heist meeting, and that he was completely in on it and a willing participant. But law enforcement believes that they're all sticking to this part of the story, and it's not true, because if it wasn't true and that this is something that they did to him against his will, that any of them, Marjorie or any of the co-conspirators, can be charged for that, and they're trying to avoid that. And there's no statute of limitation, so they are just sticking to that to avoid being charged for his death. Now, once the trial is done and everybody is handed off their little piece of time, investigators think that the case is over and done with and it's resolved. That is until 2018, when Jessica Hoopsick, the sex worker that Brian would often frequent and that he would take over to Kenneth's house, she decides that she wants to come forward and come clean with her involvement in this case and shed a little extra light on what she knew about it. Jessica claims that one day before the meetup for the heist, Kenneth, while she was at his house purchasing her goods, had approached her and asked her to find a gopher, somebody that was gullible, that they could scare into going into the bank and getting the money, and that would be too afraid to go to the police instead of actually carrying out the act. And she had been dealing with Brian for quite some time up until this point and knew that he would be that guy because she felt like he was a pushover. So she chose him and brought him over to Kenneth's house. In exchange for her offering up Brian to them as the sacrificial lamb, they gave her $1,500 and some free drugs. She said that she was coming forward now because she had deep regret. She claims to have also felt bad because he was being listed as a co-conspirator and not a victim, and that them doing this and dragging his name through the mud along with everybody else's had continued to cause his family a lot more pain than the original incident itself. So she wanted to come forward and provide that level of clarity just to clear Brian's name, because he's not here to defend himself, so it really wasn't fair. And also provide some comfort and closure to his family, who was out there still trying to convince everybody that he would never have agreed to do something like this and was not a willing participant at all. As for being there at the meeting the day before, she said that that would have been impossible because on that particular day he was with her up until about 2:30 in the afternoon, and then afterward he left her to go to work. So that would not have allowed him any time to partake in any pre-heist meeting. This was a super long story and there was a lot going on, but I want to hear your thoughts down below. Hopefully the video is not that long. Some of y'all like it long. You nasty. Please let me know your thoughts down below. Don't forget to give this video a thumbs up. Y'all showed out last video with the likes. I was like, look at y'all. I told y'all it means a lot. It helps the channel out a lot, and y'all really came through, so thank you for that. Let's keep it going. We are on the road to 100k. We are at like 91k today. I love y'all. Thank you so much for watching. As always, I appreciate you so much for spending your time here on my channel, and I will see you in the next one. Peace. She'll be able to clone him, so maybe she really loved him. No, this bitch just killed him. She didn't love him. So he had written down the destructions. This is something that he really enjoyed to do. Is that even proper English? And a call is replaced. Why do I want to say a call was replaced so bad? Oh my God, I got glue in my eye. Not me finishing the video with just one eye vision. Cause that's what's gonna happen. Who was in a, oh no, I just already put, what am I doing? I'm putting on primer again. Oh well. More foundation, yes.
my business. Bully, relax. Oh shit, is it time to feed you? You probably can't relax. No, it's not time to eat. Relax.